Hello, and welcome to this live Google Hangout. And this is part of a massive open online course being run in the School of English at the University of Sheffield called Literature of the English Country House. Last week in the course, we were discussing Jane Austen, the representation of houses in her novels and her use of style. And then this week, we use Jane Austen's Northanger Abbey to access the Gothic novel. And we discussed Radcliffe and the Gothic, and ultimately, Great Expectations by Charles Dickens. So I'm joined today by Dr. Joe Bray, and Dr. Amber Regis, our educators from week 4 and week 5. And we'll be talking to you live for the next 50 minutes. So if you have any questions, please do send those questions through. If you're watching on Google Hangout, there's actually a small square of dots in the corner of your screen. And if you hover over that, you get the option to ask a question. If you're watching this on a mobile device, I'm afraid you can't ask questions through Google Hangout, but you can pose your questions on Twitter using the hashtag FLHouseLit. And if you're one of our learners already and you're watching this on the platform, you can ask your questions by posting it in the corresponding step. Before we begin then, shall we introduce ourselves?
Yes, I'm Joe Bray. I was an educator last week in week 4 on Jane Austen, and I'm a reader here in the School of English at Sheffield. I work on Jane Austen, and I'm particularly interested in her narrative style technique.
Hi, and I'm Amber Regis. It's my pleasure to be part of the MOOC this week alongside my colleague, Professor Angela Wright, who sadly can't be with us tonight because she's attending an international conference in Vancouver on Gothic literature, and I'm sure she would have loved to have been here. I'm a lecturer in 19th century literature here in Sheffield, and my research focuses upon Victorian life writing, biography and autobiography, but I also have an interest in adaptation studies, and I've done some work on Dickens's Great Expectations.
And I'm Adam Smith, a co-lead educator on the MOOC, and I'll just be asking the questions tonight. We've got a really nice one to start with. So our first question is for both Amber and Joe. Many learners have asked, what are your favourite adaptations of Austen and Dickens? Anyone want to go first? We'll do it chronologically, so
okay.
Have you got a favourite Austen adaptation?
Yes, that's a good question. I've got quite a few, but I'm quite interested at the moment in one of the literary adaptations. I'm actually reading a book called Longbourn at the moment by Joe Baker, and it reimagines Pride and Prejudice from the point of view of the servants, who we don't see or hear very much of in the novel, but they're mentioned occasionally. And in fact, in the book, the author describes them as sort of ghostly presences in Jane Austen that sort of flit across the pages, and she's very interestingly sort of recreated their story, and we see things through their perspective. So I really enjoy that. I'm really enjoying that. And I also quite like the P.D. James one as well, Death Comes to Pemberley. So I'm quite a fan of these.
Which was filmed largely at Chatsworth House.
Yes.
Is there a tradition of sequels and spin-offs from these novels that weren't written by Austen?
Yes, I mean, there's been quite a few recently. I suppose it's partly to do with the rise in sort of fan fiction as well, because a lot of them are related to that to sort of modern trend where there's lots of rewritings. But I do like some of the filmic ones as well. Clueless, obviously, is a fantastic version.
Well, that's quite an easy one for me, because my absolute favourite adaptation of Charles Dickens's Great Expectations, of which there are many, many, many different adaptations of that novel, is David Lean's 1946 black and white version, starring Martita Hunt as Miss Havisham. It's my favourite for many reasons. I think the cinematography is absolutely beautiful. The use of black and white in that film is exquisite. One of the other reasons why I like it is perhaps more fun, is that it tries to represent on screen the complex narrative voice that Dickens achieves in that novel. At many points in the novel, Dickens has Pip externalize a conscience through interjections and sentences in brackets, and David Lean attempts to replicate this on screen with sort of varying degrees of success. But my favourite moment is when he has a cow speak, or seemingly speak, to Pip, and accusing him of being a thief for stealing a pork pie. It's a wonderful moment. I'm really funny.
Yeah. Nobody asked me, but I think my favourite Dickens adaptation is A Muppet's Christmas Carol. Oh. I think that's a fine adaptation in many ways. So we should have some more questions coming through now. Samantha Taylor asks, by Future Learn, was Jane Austen a success by the standards of her time? That's a question for you, Joe.
Yes, it's an interesting one. I mean, she was, her novels, well, we have to remember that her novels were published anonymously, so she herself wasn't famous, but her novels were becoming much more well-known by the time she, towards the end of her career, certainly following the publication of Mansfield Park in 1814. And she actually, the Prince Regent was a great fan of her work, and she actually got to meet him in the late 1850, dedicated Emma to him, although she wasn't herself as the author of it. But, so she was, by some measure, becoming more widely known, although didn't achieve great fame and success or financial remuneration during her lifetime, but it was only really sort of after her death, in fact, really till the 1830s, 1840s, and all started really taking off, and she became much more famous there, and much more of a success. But I think still, by the comparison to some of the writers of the period, she was doing pretty well. Her novel sold out, certainly, in later writers. Recommended translation, the usual thing, where they were being published as they are, so they are on the But she was certainly achieving some success, but it's only so late to draw into her image, I think, that she would have got to
copy the novel. Was Dickens there was a whole cult of child design, so I suppose, and very much himself at the helm of that cult. And when he died, he had a very elaborate, publicly attended funeral, people lying in the streets. And there is this apocryphal story, which is, of course, is of dubious origin, that when Charles Dickens did die, that there was a young girl who said on the streets of London, "Will that be there? Will be no Christmas this year?" If Charles Dickens is no longer with us.
What was Dickens' sort of breakthrough text? When did it become?
I suppose it would have been when he broke through very early as a journalist, and his sketches by Boz were very popular, I think probably Pickwick Papers, and in particular the character of Sam Weller in Pickwick Papers made him very, very popular serial.
Internationally famous. America as well, wasn't it? Made him sort of international.
Absolutely, yes. And he was one of the first writers with enough clout to dictate terms in terms of payment. And he was very angry with pirate editions and America stealing what he saw to be the money he had earned himself. And he lampoons America in Martin Chuzzlewit a little bit to get his own back, but then later signs this big money deal to go and do a lecture tour of America and really gets his own back.
excellent. So several people on the platform, this is a question for you, Joe, several people on the platform have asked if Northanger Abbey is an attack on a Gothic novel or a love letter.
That's a good question, yes. I think we can see it, as Angela says in one of the videos this week, as although it does parody certainly elements of the Gothic novel, it's also very affectionate, I think, towards it. And to parody it, you must obviously know it very well, and it's clear that Austin did know Anne Radcliffe's work in particular extremely well. And I think, although she makes fun of it, certainly throughout Northanger Abbey, with Catherine's sleepless night and the laundry bill and the black chest that she gets very worried about. But I think there's a great deal of humour, obviously, and a great deal of affection towards the Gothic. And after all, not all Catherine's readings are completely wrong in the novel, although it turns out that General Tilney hasn't murdered his wife. Nevertheless, she's right about some things about him. He does turn out to be rather a ogreish, tyrannical figure. And so I don't think Austen's certainly not suggesting that Gothic novels lead to horrendous misreadings necessarily all the time. I think there are elements that she gets right. So I think it's certainly a very affectionate treatment of the Gothic in Northanger Abbey.
Excellent. So question for you now, Amber. Although this might be something you can come in on as well, Joe. So Gene Davison says, what role does realism play in Charles Dickens's Great Expectations, in particular in the realm of Satis House?
That's a fantastic question, because Dickens's work, particularly at the mid-19th century, is taking part in a dominant trend in fiction at that time, which critics have described as fantastic realism. And so we have writers from the 40s to the 60s, like Elizabeth Gaskell, the Bronte sisters, and Dickens, who are writing novels that combine realist narratives and more fantastical narratives. And while the novel itself is probably dominantly realist and takes place in a world which could exist with probable events, there are these moments of fantastic interruption and disruption that sort of erupt into the text. So I think we should see Great Expectations in that narrative mode. And so the Satis House scenes are those fantastic interludes that interrupt and disrupt, and they draw upon Gothic tropes in order to express something which is beyond the norm in some way, something that is excessive, something that is transgressive, subversive, threatening. And so you get these Gothic interludes around the figure of Miss Havisham. And so in order to make it fantastic, you don't get the kind of detail that you would get in a realist part of the novel. So you don't find out how she lives. You don't find out how she has her breakfast, how she keeps her clothes clean, and those kinds of details. It's all left very ambiguous and unknown, and that is all part of that Gothic mode, the sort of unknowing of Satis House and Miss Havisham.
So I don't know what you think, but I always think of Great Expectations as related to the sensation fiction as Wilkie Collins and that sort of genre as well, with the idea of the sort of detective work that has to go on and sort of unravelling the mystery, you know, all those sort of elements to it as well.
Yeah, absolutely. The sensation novel is, and it's absolutely big business at this time as well. And one of Dickens's friends, one of his co-authors on many projects, and one of his financial colleagues as well, who has shares in All the Year Round, is Wilkie Collins, who publishes alongside Dickens novels like The Woman in White, which is also serialised in All the Year Round, follows that similar model, doesn't it, of these interruptions and of fantastic events.
Yes, and all those little clues for the reader to pick up. But the serialisation makes it more difficult in a way for the reader to kind of get hold of all the little clues and piece them together.
But very exciting.
But very exciting.
So, question for you now, Joe. Some learners have asked, how are free and direct discourse and stream of consciousness connected? What are the differences?
Yes, that's a good one. I mean, there's certainly a relationship between the two. I mean, we often see Jane Austen, the start of the 19th century, is the beginning of free and direct discourse, which is developed throughout the 19th century novel. And then when we get to the modernists, Henry James and the modernists in the early 20th century, obviously, in Virginia Woolf, you get something that's related to that, and it's sort of often called stream of consciousness. I think the way I would see it is stream of consciousness being a kind of overall term for the kind of things that Woolf and other modernists do, which includes free and direct discourse within it. So I'd see stream of consciousness as a more overall term, which can include other things like what's sometimes called interior monologue, where you have a character's thoughts apparently coming straight out in first person, present tense, as if they're what they're thinking aloud. And that's not quite what we get in Austen, which is free and direct discourse, which is kind of, as we've been looking at this week, a mixture of the character and the narrator's thoughts. So I think what Woolf and other modernists are doing is definitely related. And Henry James certainly was a big fan of Jane Austen, that takes the style in new directions, I think, which the modernists then pick up on as well. So they're connected, certainly, but I would see free and direct discourse as a slightly more specific term than stream of consciousness, which is a bit more broad and can refer to lots of other things as well. But it's a good question, and they're definitely related. And it shows, I think, how important Austen is for the history of the novel, that writers like Woolf and Joyce, over a century later, are still picking up on things that she had a big hand in in developing.
Yeah. Cool. There's a question here, which I think we've already partly touched on. The question is, many learners have asked, how did both Austen and Dickens engage with Gothic traditions? But this just brings to mind a discussion that I saw on the MOOC this week about authors engaging with different traditions. And I think it was actually Trevor Jenkins who said that the way the material had been presented on the course made it look like Jane Austen was a big fan fiction writer herself. So she sort of wrote her own Samuel Richardson stories and then wrote her own responses to Radcliffe. So I suppose we can answer this question about tradition, but also I was wondering about that issue of intertextuality and what writers these writers are writing to. So Austen, Richardson, Richardson and Radcliffe. Is there anyone like that for Dickens?
I have no idea, is the short answer. Certainly, in this sort of fantastic realist mode that I was talking about earlier, what we see in Dickens is thematic motifs coming through, which he's inherited from the 18th century and the Romantic period. In order to achieve sort of Gothic effects in Great Expectations, what Dickens has, he has plot lines about inheritance, about parentage, about enclosing spaces, about tyranny. And these are things that he has taken from people like Anne Radcliffe, mm-hmm. Horace Walpole, Matthew Monk Lewis. So it might not be as explicit as the kind of borrowing that Austen is doing in Northanger, which has this special sort of affectionate parody, but he is absolutely sort of indebted to, in order to achieve those effects, he's indebted to the literary tradition of the Gothic that comes before him.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Yes. Was there anybody else that Austen was speaking to?
Yes, well, there's a wonderful passage in Northanger Abbey where she sort of defends the novel from attack. The narrator sort of steps in and talks about Camilla, mm-hmm. Cecilia and Belinda. So that's Fanny Burney and Maria Edgeworth. Mm-hmm. And I think those are also very important influences on Austen's style. And from these novels, in fact, Free and Direct Discourse, which we've been talking about this week, you can find in these earlier novelists. So it's not as if Jane Austen suddenly invented something new, but she was clearly very influenced by her contemporaries, and not just Radcliffe, but also Burney and Edgeworth and Charlotte Smith as well, another important writer. So I think, yes, we should see this period as one where writers are very much writing back and forth with each other, developing each other's thoughts and ideas together. And perhaps, I don't know if that's quite the same in today's literary culture, where perhaps writers a bit more isolated in what they do, I don't know. But certainly in this period, they're very much interacting with each other. And it leads back, of course, earlier in the 18th century, Samuel Richardson and Henry Fielding, which is really where the novel, partly where the novel gains its strength in the mid-18th century, were very, their works are very interconnected. Mm-hmm. You could see them parodying each other and a great rivalry between them. And I think that carries on later in the century with Austen and her contemporaries.
It strikes me as though, on a more practical level, Dickens's collaboration with other writers in his magazines is doing a similar but different thing in the mid-19th century. So just to take an example, Household Words and All the Year Rounds, which are the magazine that Dickens conducts in his own terminology throughout the mid-century. At Christmas, they would have always had a special double number, a long issue, and Dickens would provide a frame narrative and a couple of stories, but all the other stories would be written by other writers like Eliza Lynn Linton or Wilkie Collins, Elizabeth Gaskell. And so in that sense, they are all collaboratively working together to produce the stories of Mugby Junction or The Haunted House. But in fact, they're all writing individually, but collaboratively at the same time. Mm-hmm. And Dickens is a ferocious editor and says very unkind things about a lot of his contributors, particularly Mrs. Gaskell.
Okay, there's a question here for both of you. So what is the significance of using young protagonists in these novels? So you've got Pip in Great Expectations, young Catherine in Northanger Abbey. I mean, why do you think that, how does that work?
I think Joe and I have both instantly thought of the word Bildungsroman. But I think because, again, this is So Bildungsroman is a particular, it's a German word, and it describes a particular plot type in which a young character goes from innocence to sort of maturity, and it enters the adult world and becomes part of the social milieu in some way, is integrated into society. So we have that with Pip. We have his movement from childhood and naivety into adulthood and maturity. His integration is problematic. It's unfulfilled and it's left unsatisfactory. He's quite sad, and depending on which ending of Great Expectations you are reading, he can be isolated and alone. So his integration at the end of that Bildungsroman plot is questionable, but not as problematic as female Bildungsroman, which is when I'm going to hand over to Jo Bray.
Yes, I mean, I think Jane Austen, most of Jane Austen's heroines are pretty young, and it's very much about their development and education. She was very interested in ideas about female learning. Mm. And this is a very hot topic, of course, when she's writing, because how were young girls to be educated, how to be brought into the world, and what kind of things should they read, is an absolutely fundamental question that's very important at all sorts of levels in late 18th century society. So I think she is very interested in these questions about the development of the heroine. How is she to make sense of the world around her? And you see most of her novels are about this growth and this kind of, as you say, development, which is definitely where the Bildungsroman fits in. And the exception, of course, might be Anne Elliot in Persuasion, who's seen as sort of mature, and she's 26.
I think.
Yeah. So she's seen as already having passed through all that 8 years ago. Oh. And so this is a rather... it shows, I think, the typical sort of age of the heroines of this period. And Austen wasn't alone. I mean, a lot of writers in this period have young, what we would now think of young girls, really, as heroines. Yeah. Because I think this question of their education is fundamental.
Mm-hmm. We've got a question here from Christina Strain. And Christina, I think the first part of this question, which is about why does Dickens use Gothic elements in a world of realism? We sort of touched on at the start of the discussion, but the second part is, do you think the fact that Miss Havisham is a miss and not a mister plays into this sort of magical realm in this realist novel?
Well, yes, because as a single woman who is not, and she has withdrawn from a particular social organisation, which is based around familial relationships with fathers, brothers, or husbands. So her father is dead. Her half-brother has swindled her out of her money and her shares in a family business and has gone off. And her fiancé has abandoned her. So what we have is, and this makes me very uncomfortable to say, is a superfluous woman in the terms of that particular mid-19th century social machine, social organization. And so because she cannot be easily sort of labeled as wife, sister, daughter any longer, she sort of is a transgressive figure and therefore can be quite easily co-opted into these Gothic, fantastic narratives, because she's not doing the kinds of things that we want female characters to do. She's not even a widow who is a female figure that has passed out of those patriarchal relationships, but at least was once part of them. And widow figures are often associated with independence and mobility in literature from the 18th and 19th century because of this privileged social position that they have. But having said that, widows can, in different genres, also be exceptional transgressive figures like Miss Havisham. And there's sometimes, with underlying misogynist undertones, representations of widows as sort of lusty women that can be very desirable and desired. Yeah.
Eliza Hayward's Fantomina. Mm.
Yes.
It's a widow of that kind, isn't she?
Yes.
That gives her the power to
adopt the guise of a widow in Fantomina. Yes.
Well, there's a question here that's come through from YouTube, asked by Lily Blanco. And Lily Blanco says, I heard that the Bronte sisters disliked reading Jane Austen. Why do you think they did not like her novels? This is a question for both of you. Thank you.
Wow, that's a good one. I'm not sure whether they... I don't know if that's true. I'll take your word for it. But I suspect if it is, then it could be something to do with the... what they might have seen as the constriction and the narrow focus of Jane Austen's novels, who said that she her material was three or four families in a country village, whereas they have the Bronte novels typically have, I suppose, a much broader sweep and much more overtly melodramatic themes, perhaps. But I think this would be a bit unfair if that's what they did think, because I think Austen's novels, although they are constrained in some ways in terms of the social groupings that they depict, also range quite widely but subtly around the political issues of the day, I think, such as the wars with Napoleonic wars with France and other issues to do with the female education that were actually very deeply political and important in the period. But I guess they are different. I mean, Wuthering Heights is a very different kind of novel to Pride and Prejudice. But I think there are equally strong elements to both. I wouldn't want to take sides in this, in this debate.
So, Amber, which is better, Austen?
Well, I like them both, but I think it's ringing bells, actually. I'm pretty sure that Emily or Charlotte did actually have, I think it might be Charlotte, have not unkind things to say about Jane Austen's novels, but was a critical reader. Mm. Which is interesting because in subsequent years, it's the Brontes and Austen that have often been, as you say, sort of which is best, have often been set side by side and comparisons drawn, certainly in A Room of One's Own. Virginia Woolf does just this, and she comes down very much on the side of Austen, that it's Austen's precision, it's Austen's calm, and it's her careful handling of the sentence that sets her apart. And in fact, Virginia Woolf, though she admired the Brontes' writing, feels like the novels are misshapen somehow by a lack of precision and a lack of calm, and anger, in fact, coming into their work. So that's a really interesting discussion of those writers' works in Virginia Woolf's A Room of One's Own.
Cool. We've got a question here, which is for both of you again. So several people have suggested that both Satie's House and Northanger Abbey are haunted and welcoming spaces in contrast with those hospitable houses that we encounter in week one and two. So if people who aren't already learners on the course, sign up and have a look at this. So we had sort of Ben Johnson's to Penhurst. We had in week two, we had manuscripts that were celebrating the benevolence of owners and things. Whereas here we've got a sort of more haunted house and a less hospitable space. Does this reflect changes in the country house during the 18th and 19th centuries, do you think?
I think that's an interesting one for Northanger Abbey because, of course, that's Catherine's expectation that it will be sort of haunted, and she spends a very turbulent first night sort of tossing and turning, worrying about it. But as she actually looks more around the house, she finds that it's actually much more modern, and it's got, in fact, a sort of modern wing, hasn't it, that the general has sort of done it up. And he's sort of done lots of home improvements. And that she finds, well, they go against her expectations of what an abbey should be like. But I think that does show that the country house was, always being developed and improved upon, I suppose. And she's rather disappointed in a way that she finds this sort of modern taste, which goes against what she was expecting. But yes, I suppose it is a more hospitable space than perhaps she was expecting. Yes, but whether this is typical of all country houses in this period, I'm not certain. But they probably were changing according to the tastes of the time. Mm-hmm.
we might see this come through more clearly in later fiction, particularly in the kind of fantastic realism or sensation genres that Dickens is writing in. Yeah. And because of the genres that he is using in his novels, it sort of predisposes him to represent the country house in a particular way, of course. So in several other of Dickens's works, country houses aren't exactly happy, welcoming spaces either. So Lester Dedlock's house in Bleak House isn't exactly welcoming, and it's a place full of secrets, much like Satis House is full of secrets. And what Satis House really brings to the fore, in fact, is that fear of modernity, which becomes a point of humour in Northanger Abbey, and it's that disjunction between what Catherine expects and what she finds that makes you sort of raise an eyebrow and a smile. Yes. In Satis House, in Great Expectations, you have an encroaching modernity all around Satis House. Pip has to travel to London, and you get the impression of sort of Satis House being surrounded by a world that is modernizing and urbanizing at this particular time of industrial progress. And Satis House isn't moving forward, it's not keeping up, it's becoming a relic, it's decaying and falling down. And of course, by the end of the novel, it's cleared to make way for new buildings. That modernity wipes it out. So those anxieties are coming through. And that's why in Dickens, I think it's an unwelcoming, haunted space.
There's a question here. It's just come through from Stephanie Polsky, and it's a question for you, Amber. It's quite a specific question. So on one of the steps this week, you classify Pip's second visit to Satis House, where he is depicted walking Miss Havisham around her decrepit dining table, as a work visit as opposed to a play visit. How do you distinguish those?
In order to answer that, I think I'll go back to the first visit. So when Pip goes to Satis House in Chapter 8 of Great Expectations, it's a very odd moment where he arrives in the dressing room and first meets Miss Havisham, and she commands him to play, and he doesn't really know what to do, and he says he can't play in such a dismal space, and ultimately end up playing. They play at cards, and that's a very important moment in that first visit. When he returns, he is not functioning in the same way on that second visit. So I'm hoping I'm not mixing different visits together in my head, but I think on the second visit, first of all, Pip is paraded in front of Miss Havisham's other relatives, and he's very much being exploited and used in order to upset those other relatives, the pocket family that are there. And then when he is shown up to, this time, the dining room, he is commanded to help help carry and support Miss Havisham as she walks and paces round and round. So it's a very different kind of function that he has, from play to actually being sort of an instrumental figure with a purpose in that second visit. I can't remember on the spot whether she uses the word work, but certainly that is his it's more akin to his function in that second visit. So I think that's why I use that word.
Okay, there's a question here from Margaret Harris, which sounds quite simple, but potentially if we unpack this, we could be here for a very long time. So Margaret Harris on Future Learn asks, when reading a novel, how would one recognise an unreliable narrator? And I wonder if we could extend that to say a few words about the different narrators. So we've got Pip, numerous Pips, in Great Expectations, and sort of the narrator in Northanger Abbey. It's not a first-person narration, is it?
No, but what's quite interesting about Jane Austen's narrators is that they do sometimes step in the first person. So they're not involved in the world of the story, as in a novel like Great Expectations, but they are presences nevertheless, and we can sometimes sense their opinions on things, and very often they'll intervene at the end of a novel to wrap it up. And I think that happens in Northanger Abbey. Certainly it does at the end of Mansfield Park, which I've been looking at recently, where the narrator will sort of come in and try and summarise plot developments that might seem a bit implausible. So often the narrator comes in at a moment where something has to be explained that otherwise might seem a bit unlikely. And you very often get a sense there of, I don't know if I'd say unreliable, but some sort of uncertainty, certainly with Austin's narrators when they come in the first person like that. It's as if they're trying to strain to justify the plot and plot developments. But generally the narrator is a back, more of a background presence, I suppose, in Austin's novels. And very often it's ambiguous as to whether we're getting the narrator's opinion or the character's opinion. I mean, that, I suppose, is another kind of unreliability, that you don't always know who's speaking and whose voice it is, whether it's the narrator's or the character's point of view. But it's, yeah, her narrators are certainly more interesting than might first appear. But it's a different kind of thing when the narrator is actually a character, I suppose, as in Great Expectations.
That's right. When the narrator is also the character, when the fiction is posed to you as an autobiography of some kind, you're instantly aware very quickly as a reader that you're reading that partial account. Pip, as I said earlier at the beginning of the hangout, interjects and comments upon his thoughts and how he is retelling his story, and you're very aware that this is very much his version of events. I think the master of unreliable narration, or the masters of unreliable narration at this time, are the Bronte sisters. Mm-hmm. So you know very quickly in Wuthering Heights, for instance, that things are very complicated and unreliable because you have so many frames. So that's the sort of jargon word that people use to say that there are different narrators layered one on top of the other. So we have Lockwood telling us about Nellie's story. And Nellie is a narrator that intervenes or chooses not to intervene at really important moments in Wuthering Heights. And you never get the sense that Nellie is telling you the whole story. And then Nellie's partial account is also Lockwood's partial account. So it's the first person is a really important tool in unreliable narration. A really useful counterpoint to this is 10 years after Great Expectations, you have George Eliot's masterpiece, Middlemarch. And if you look at how she narrates with that sort of all-seeing, godlike voice, you're meant to trust in that narrator. Yeah. You're meant to be educated and informed by that narrator and guided by that narrator. The narrator will often offer a little lecture or a digression, telling you how to read and respond to events. So comparing something like Wuthering Heights or Lucy Snow in Villette, who even tells you she's not going to tell you the truth, to George Eliot's Middlemarch, that's a really good set of comparisons to think about reliable and so-called unreliable narration.
Of course, as you've been saying this week, the tension, if I haven't you, in the first person narrative between the older and the younger self. So the younger self may see things that we know the older self knows are wrong. So you've got a kind of unreliability there that one knows more than the other.
That's right. And absolutely, because one of the real problems in first person retrospective narration that is pretending to be an autobiography is that, of course, Pip, who is narrating our story, knows all the twists and turns and the mysteries. And so Pip, who is remembering the story, has to not tell you things as a reader to keep you in suspense. Yes. So the reader doesn't discover who the benefactor is till the last third of the novel. Yes, but of course the Pip who's telling the story is known all along, but he just hasn't told you. So yes, that distinction of the two temporal moments is really important.
What do you think of that? There was something in the news this week, wasn't there, about Charles Dickens inventing time travel? And actually, in terms of narrative structure, you can see how that works, and that you've got the older Pip witnessing the younger Pip making mistakes that he remembers, and we're watching it with this temporally confusing, isn't it?
The time is very carefully balanced.
There's a question here from Janice Westwood, and I think actually Margaret's question, which we just answered, speaks to a lot of this, but I just thought we'd check it, seeing we're on the same ground. So Janice Westwood says, Austin uses a lot of dialogue and free and direct discourse to express inner voices, whereas the realists, such as Dickens, perhaps use more descriptive and strong authorial narrative voices. Mm. Is there anything to add to this?
Yes, I mean, that's true of Austin, I think, yes. There's very little sort of narratorial exposition, as you might get in a novel like Middlemarch. Very little sense of the narrator sort of imposing a moral perspective, but it is there kind of subtly. And as I've said, the first person narrator does intervene at actually quite a few strategic moments. So there is some of what we might call description there, but I suppose that is true that as we go into further into the 19th century, the more strong authorial narrative voice emerges more. I don't know whether I generalise totally up across the whole century about that, but so that might be a bit like of a
different authors using different techniques. Yeah. Certainly, I think you could probably apply that to Dickens's career. His early works, so his sort of journalistic writings and something like Oliver Twist, does a similar thing to what Austin does in Northanger Abbey, when you have these interjections. I'm not saying he's using free and direct discourse, but he has in Oliver Twist, you get these moments where he steps out of telling his story, this narrator figure, to tell you something about the poor law, or something about how children are being sort of neglected. And he will almost have a sort of a polemic speech, and then you're back in the story. Dickens does settle down in his style and tends to adopt third person narration. It's only David Copperfield and it's only Great Expectations that have the first person retrospective narrator. David Copperfield is telling his story, Pip is telling his story. But I don't think David Copperfield achieves the narrative complexity that he achieves in Great Expectations. I think he sort of refined his style, I suppose, and he has, he's got it.
Going back to the 18th century, and I suppose the one model might have been the Henry Fielding. Mm. So there is a kind of very strong authorial narrative voice, and certainly George Eliot was consciously draws on Fielding, doesn't she, in Middlemarch. So that would sort of counter a kind of narrative you know, I think you're right, different authors pick up and do it in different ways, but certainly there was a model there in the 18th century for that kind of very strong narratorial process.
That's right. The grand historian, doesn't she?
We take our seats and
listen to the grand master.
Yes. So certainly it was there.
Yeah.
It was just Austin, I suppose, chooses to do something a little bit different.
It's a bit innovative. Yeah.
That last question, thinking about the narrators and stuff and the idea that Dickens is a first person adopting that autobiographical mode. I mean, we see this right at the start of the Rise of the Novel, don't we, with like Moll Flanders as this confessional tradition.
Yes. And you've got there as well, in Not of Defoe's writing, a tension between the older self, who's kind of supposedly reformed and gone through, like Moll has gone through lots of different kinds of reformation, but the older self and the younger self, who's more naive and making mistakes and falling into various trouble of different kinds. So yes, I think definitely that draws on that sort of confessional kind of autobiographical narrative.
Okay, there's a question here by Christina Strain that's been languishing at the top of our pile for a while. It's a popular question as well. It's got quite a few likes, and it's about Great Expectations. So in the novel Great Expectations, which is very much about beginnings and origins, Christina says, what is the significance of death and decay occurring within the country house?
I think that links back to what I was saying earlier about there being a sense at this time that the country house was a thing of a different, older order, and that with the sort of leaps forward in industrial technologies, with the urban sprawl that begins in the 18th century, that country houses are being encroached upon. They're no longer strictly rural. A lot of them are demolished. Many of them are demolished, or they're swallowed up in quite awkward ways by townships. That if this is a social institution that seems to be dying out. There are, of course, some remarkable survivals. Some country houses are still today in the private hands of resident families. But this is a time when, and from the 18th century into the 19th century, when the middling classes are becoming the new professional urban industrial middle classes, that the shift imbalance of wealth and power is sort of bulging in the middle with the middle classes, and those that owned the country houses are no longer as powerful as they might once have been. The vote, for instance, had already been expanded. The franchise was extended, in the 1830s. Already at the time of Dickens's writing, there are agitations for its further expansion, which comes later in the century. So the idea of, political economic power is shifting down the social scale, and the actual fabrics of the buildings are under threat. So that's possibly why death and decay are happening in these spaces, in these Gothic novels.
There's a question here about the different methods that these texts were published in. So would you like to say a few words about how these appeared and the differences between the way that Austin would have published Northanger? Northanger's got an amazing publication history, isn't it? Was it sort of, and then also Great Expectations. So do you want to start us off, Joe?
Yes, I mean, Austin's novels didn't have the serialization aspect that we get later on, but they would certainly have been subject to, they did come out in different editions, so there might have been a second edition published during the author's lifetime. But for serialization, I mean, one has to go back a bit to what we were talking about on the last week in Samuel Richardson and the longer novels of the 18th century, which did come out in sort of separate volumes, so you'd have to wait a little bit. But for Austin's novels, I suppose, because they were shorter, they did all come out in one chunk, though some came out posthumously after her. After her death, but certainly the serialization, I think, does add quite a big effect on how a novel would have been received and responded to, as we saw last week with Richardson and with Dickens this week.
Yes, absolutely. There's a step on the platform which sort of talks in more detail than I'll be able to now about how Great Expectations came out in All the Year Round, which was a magazine that Dickens edited and he co-owned, so he was in charge, very much in charge of the way that Great Expectations appeared. There is an explosion of prints as technologies improve in the 19th century, and magazines that were printing serial fiction were sort of being set up and failing very quickly all over the place. So there's lots of different avenues to get your print fiction, I suppose. So if you want to be less specific about Dickens, there was just more. There's more. I think this was going back to your week with the relaxation of the Licensing Act, this wave of print, and then as technologies and costs come, technologies are better and cost comes down, it just increases. So it could be seen as quite an ephemeral form that you might throw away and keep, but rather than keep. But it's very clear that Dickens wants you to not throw his material away. He has aspirations to prestige in All the Year Round. He talks very much about the leading serial fiction that's always going to be at the front of his magazine. And he then prints, so you can buy it weekly, but then you can also buy the annual of All the Year Round. So you could go out and buy that year's copies in a big book, or you could go out and buy the book of Great Expectations. So there's lots of print out there, but you can also buy the same set of texts in multiple ways, which is very, very shrewd business practice. He was a very smart man.
Yeah. It's a timely moment to be talking about All the Year Round, given recent events.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, so very, very exciting news in recent weeks, which was announced at the Research in Victorian Periodicals Conference a few weeks ago. Dr. Jeremy Parrott has acquired some copies of All the Year Round, the bound annual volumes, and a complete set, and they turn out to be Dickens's copies from the office of All the Year Round, with the names of the people who wrote each article next to the article, and a lot of that knowledge was lost. It was impossible to know who wrote some of these articles, because it was not common practice to sign your name to an article in a periodical until much later. And suddenly we can know that Wilkie Collins wrote this or Elizabeth Gaskell wrote that, and we can work out that some things people thought Wilkie Collins written didn't. So we're finally able to piece together how this business culture of fiction writing actually was working in practice.
Well, thank you very much. Remarkably, we are coming to the end of our time. So thank you both. And thank you very much for all of your questions as well. We hope you've enjoyed the discussion. And remember that this video will be available to rewatch if you want to watch it again, or if you've missed it live, you won't see this, will you? But if you would like to watch it again, it'll be available on YouTube and also on the Google Hangout. And if you'd like to hear more about things we've been discussing this week, you can also look at last year's Google Hangout, which we filmed almost exactly a year ago. And that's Amber discussing Great Expectations and Charles Dickens. And also Angela Wright, who couldn't join us this evening, discussing the Gothic novel. If you aren't already enrolled on the course, there's still 1 week left. So the information is below this video to sign up, and I heartily recommend it. Next week will be our final week on the course, and we'll be charting the decline of the country house into the writing of Oscar Wilde. And we'll also just be tying up loose ends, and eventually we'll exit through the gift shop. So until then, it's good night from Joe.
Good night.
Good night from Amber.
Good night.
And it's good night from me. Thanks very much for listening.